Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. God bless you, God bless you, God bless you. Welcome to the Burns Memorial Church. Once again, this is our Sunday morning Bible study. Amen, amen. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you, we praise you, we magnify your name, we lift you up this morning, and we just give you all the praise, all the glory, Lord. We ask that you come in, give us a word, Lord. Give us a word that we can chew on all week, Lord, digest, and then regurgitate it towards our walk in faith, Lord. And we give you glory in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to thank God for Jesus, who laid the foundation. Thank God for Jesus, who opened up the way. Thank God for Jesus, who leadeth me each day. Thank God, thank God, thank God. Old folks used to say, come on, saints, thank God for Jesus who laid the foundation. Thank God for Jesus who opened up the way. Thank God for Jesus who leadeth me each day. Thank God, thank God, thank God. Amen, amen. I'm giving honor to the Spirit of the Lord this morning. God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. Amen. We've been teaching on the race. So my subject this morning is the race, part four. Amen. And I want to read 1 Corinthians, the 9th chapter, 24th verse. And it says, know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize. So run that ye may obtain. Run that ye may obtain. Now, you know that scripture is connotating that some people are actually running this race and not obtaining, not getting anything for it. Can you imagine living your whole life and serving God, being in church? You know, there's a lot of folks doing that. We got everything down pat, all the, you know, we know how to do church. And then you die and you don't make it into the kingdom. After all of that, that would be a tragedy. But it's going to happen to a lot of us. We have to be conscious about what we're doing. We have to be present about what we're doing. A lot of us are in la la land. And just doing. We're going through the motions. But Paul said this is a race. Okay? This is a contest. Okay? And it's not, you're not competing with somebody else, but literally, you're competing with yourself. You're battling your spirit and your flesh are warring against each other. All right? And we have to run to obtain the prize. Now, me, I don't do nothing for nothing. Okay? I got to get something for anything that I do. Whether it just be satisfaction. I don't know about you, but I don't want to expend no energy and not get something for expending my energy. If I walk up a flight of stairs, I walk with purpose. Okay? If I walk down the block, I walk with purpose. There's an agenda. When I go through my day, everything that I do, I must feel like I have accomplished something. Now, maybe it's because I've gotten a little older and I've gotten to that place in my life. Because I notice a lot of young folks, y'all just wasting time, just going through the motions, doing what you do. But can I tell you something? A long time ago, I locked into this mindset that nothing should be wasted. And I believe that's God. That's a God mindset. Nothing. When I dated my wife, and she was my wife at the time, when I dated my wife, right? I would go and get a hair done. I would buy her some certain things. But you know what I was thinking in my mind? I don't know about her. I was saying I was making an investment in my future because I knew that she was going to be my wife. Okay? So every piece of clothes that I bought her when we dated is hanging in my closet after I got married. You understand what I'm saying? We should not waste anything. This is a race. Okay? And then in a race, I'm going to get to the next part, because I said today we're going to talk about certain things, right? I just want to put this out there, though. But in a race, there you pace yourself. There's a certain cadence that you have to be in, a certain rhythm. It has a flow to it, people. And we got to, the Bible said that the steps of a good man is ordered by the Lord. So God places the ordered steps out there, and we step into it. And if you notice, there's a distance between each step. Okay? So as we step into it, you'll notice it's timing. There's a cadence. There's a way we walk, a way we flow. And when you get into that cadence, when you get into that flow, you see that things will begin to materialize. The manifestations of the Son of God, sons of God, will begin to materialize. You understand? What was in you will begin to be manifested on the earth. Your destiny walk has cadence. So we have to lock into the Spirit of God. We have to lock into the mind of God to really catch the cadence, catch the pace. A lot of times we're running ahead of God, or we're running behind schedule, sitting up there waiting, letting our flesh keep us sitting when we should be walking. You understand? Or letting our flesh keep us running when we should be walking. That's why you have to know that you got to be strategic about what we are doing. The race is not given to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, but he that endures to the end. Okay? So I don't run out there, and then I don't sprint out there like a strong man, but I am literally, you understand, flowing with the Holy Spirit. And I told you before, the Greek word for that is sunantilamanoma, which means that the Holy Spirit goes before you, walks alongside of you, and then pushes you to a thing. So it all encompasses you, the Holy Spirit. And it's just bringing you into destiny, bringing you. People are always wondering, well, what's my purpose and what's my destiny? Listen, you don't have to wonder about your destiny when you are walking in cadence with God. Enoch, the Bible said, he walked so much in cadence with God till he was no more. You understand? God translated him. He found a portal to step through that took him from earth into glory. You understand? According to his walk, it was a walk of obedience. A race of obedience. Paul said, I press towards the mark, which is the high calling in Christ Jesus. Okay, now on Thursday, I said I wanted to talk about some of the races that we know. Y'all ever heard of the decathlon? Okay, now hundreds of years ago, what we call the decathlon now was called the Pentheon. Okay. And we get that word, Pentheon is a Greek word, which means 10. Okay? 10. Now, where have you seen 10 in the Bible? What does 10 mean in the Bible, the number 10? Well, there's three numbers that mean almost the same in the Bible. 3, 7, and 10. And it means completeness. Okay? 3, 7, and 10. It means finished. Completeness. Okay. Now, where else do we see 10? God gave us 10 commandments. You ever wonder why it was 10 and not 11 and not 9? Okay. Now, if you look at the commandments, the first four commandments are upward towards God. All right. Vertical. If you read them. And then the next six are horizontal, kind of dealing with man and humanity. You understand what I'm saying? Or horizontal, but we're not going to get into that. So, the decathlon, which means 10, in the decathlon, there are 10 events that you run, okay, that you race. We're going to use the word race. It's the 100 meter, the 400 meter, the 1500 meter, and then it's the 110 meter hurdle, the javelin throw, the discus throw, the shot put, the pole vault, the high jump, and the long jump. Those are the modern day events of the decathlon. Now, wrestling used to be a part of it, okay? But no more, okay? Now, notice, they only allow men to do the decathlon, which I'm sure is going to change soon. But it is such a grueling event. It encompasses everything. Because you got to understand something. In that event, you have four runs, three jumps, three throws. Okay? And we're going to deal with that because the number three. So you got 3 and 10 there. Okay? So this decathlon, it is to produce the ultimate athlete, to see who is the ultimate athlete, okay? So it deals with every aspect of the physical body, mentally and spiritually, this race, all right? It takes all of that to get through, to finish that thing, okay? So let's deal with that decathlon, because Paul says we're in a race. And I like to liken that race like a decathlon. Okay? You notice when David said, "Yea, do I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil." As part of David's race, there was death there. And this decathlon, if you have anything in your body that's lacking, anything in your physical attribute that's lacking, this race is going to bring it out. This race is going to pick at it. You could die in this race if you have any heart issues or any circulatory issues or any blood issues. You understand what I'm saying? You could die in this race. All right? So let's still deal with this race now. Now, in a decathlon, when you do your 400 meter run or your 100 meter run, the next event, between every event, there's a half an hour break. There's a half an hour break. Okay? So you rest for a half an hour. And I started thinking about Paul talking about, you know, this race that we're in. Okay? And how Ecclesiastes, Solomon talks about it's not given to the swift or the strong. Do you not know the hardest part of the decathlon is not running, or it's not shot putting, or it's not high jumping? It's the rest in between. Because you got to understand something. You will run, and then you got to rest a half an hour. It is in that half an hour that you are literally battling to get up to do the next event. Because what happens is, when you're running, the adrenaline is flowing. Or when you're jumping, your adrenaline is flowing to help you to get past that event and to achieve that event. But you gotta understand something. When you stop and rest, now your mind is thinking about the next event, the next pain, the next issue, the next thing that's coming. Have you ever noticed that in your walk with God? You know, God has brought you through something mightily. Say if it was the doctor told you, you know, you had something, and now you had to believe God for your healing, and you got your healing. And then now you're at what you think is a peacetime in your life, and the enemy starts playing with you. He starts telling you, yeah, you're just waiting for the next shoe to drop, waiting for the next time he's going to bother you. Because the Bible says, resist the devil and he'll flee from you, right? Which connotates that he leaves and he comes back. He leaves and he comes back. In this race that we are, that's why Paul said, I press. There's always going to be a comeback of the enemy. There's always going to be an attack. The Bible said, woe to them that are at ease in Zion. Woe to you that are relaxed in this thing, because you can't get relaxed. You got to know that you got a mark on you once you accept Christ. You got to know that you're a target. That's why it talks about fiery darts of the enemy, putting up your shield of faith in this race to keep the darts from coming. Hellhounds on your, old folks say, hellhounds on your track. All right? Chasing you down all the time. A lot of folks walk away and quit this race because of the consistent attack of the enemy. They said, man, when I was in my sin, it was just so peaceful. Nobody bothered me. I enjoyed my sin. Well, of course, if the devil already has you, why do he need to mess with you? Do you get what I'm saying? He's going to target those that are coming up against his kingdom. The kingdom of heaven suffers violence, but the violent take it by force. We suffer these things. Jesus said, these things need be in this race. They need to be because they're working for you. James said the working and the testing and the trying of your faith worketh patience. So it is in these wait times, these half an hour breaks in your decathlon. The enemy, he comes and he messes with you. But you got to do like David and Ziklag. He encouraged himself in the Lord. All right? He looked to the hills from whence cometh his help. The Bible says, see, those breaks, you're waiting for your next event. The Bible said, they that wait on the Lord shall renew. That's the time that in your decathlon that you're supposed to be renewing, getting renewed, ready, invigorated to do the next one. All right? Getting hyped up, getting hypey, you know what I'm saying? To do the next one, to go the next round. See, winners never quit, but quitters never win. Do you know that? You quit, you can't win. My wife, we was discussing this race I'm in right now, in this fight that I've been in for the last, 3 years, right? Heavy fight, court battles and everything else. And these folks, I was preaching in the pulpit and they got me arrested for preaching. got the cuss put on me and spent the night in jail for preaching. Dragged me out of the church in front of the congregation because they lied and said I wasn't supposed to be in there. All right? And told all these lies and got me dragged out of the church parsonage and arrested. And, of course, the Lord put me back, gave me the parsonage and, gave me back the other building and all that. But my wife says, what makes you keep going? Why do you keep going? Because she said, I would have just said, forget this. Too much. Who want to go through all of that? And I told her, I says, because I keep my mind focused on the end result. So no matter what the enemy does, no matter the lies they tell, no matter they can use the police, the courts, or whatever, I'm going to keep going because it ain't over till it's over. And as long as I can get back up again, we fall down, but we get up. Long as I can get back up again, I'm going to keep fighting. But that's how I was as a child. You understand? You hit me, I hit you back, and we keep fighting. You beat me up, I'm still going to keep on. You got to kill me if you want me to quit. You understand? Now, sometimes I ran because there was too many coming at me. But when it was a one-on-one, I fight, and I keep fighting. And that's all I know. I'm like Oprah Winfrey. All my life, I had to fight. And I'm like that other guy who he said, I'm still standing, still strong. Do you understand? Because the Bible says, when you have done all to stand therefore. You understand? In other words, that says to me that even when I get to the place of depletion, I still stand. You got to kill me for me not to get back up again. What did Jesus say? Jesus said, tear this temple down. In 3 days, I'll raise it again. Tear it down. But I'm going to raise it again. And they tore it down, didn't they? But on that third day morning, didn't he get up? And he got up and said, I got all power. All power now. Y'all done messed up now. That's how I am. You hit me and you didn't knock me out with that, with your hit. Now I'm like, oh, you can't knock me out. Oh, now you messed up. Because I'm swinging and I'm swinging and I'm swinging. I don't know nothing else. That's how we got to be in this race. This decathlon. I get through my 100 meters. And now I'm waiting that half an hour for my 400 meter. I get through my 400 meter. And now I'm waiting another half an hour for my 1500 meter. You know what I'm saying? Then now it's the hurdles. Oh, man. Let's deal with some hurdles. Hurdles in this race, y'all. There's some hurdles. What hurdles do we have to jump in this race? I can think of one. Rejection. The hurdle of rejection. That thing gets me. Because from a child, I was rejected by my own family. Okay? When you reject, I don't want to get into it because folks start talking. And I start talking about my family because they're presiding bishops now and all kind of stuff. But I was the child that was rejected the most, regardless of what was being said. So anytime I suffer rejection, it hurts. I mean, the slightest little rejection. I got to keep, every time and I deal with that rejection thing, I got to keep pushing. Keep pushing. Wondering why people don't even know me, but they don't like me. Somebody on one of my sermons put a frown face, a mean, angry face. And I'm like, I never did that to that person. Why they put an angry face on my message? Right? I don't know why, but I thought about it. It's because they probably done heard somebody say something about me and never got to really know me. You understand what I'm saying? Rejection. That's a hurdle. But we gotta get over that. We gotta jump over those rejections because we gotta say, for Christ I live and for Christ I die. Nobody got more rejected than Jesus Christ. The Bible said he came unto his own and his own received him not, but to as many as received him, to those that didn't reject him, he gave them power to become the sons of God. You understand? So you get over those hurdles because there's, you got a destiny. You got people to reach in this walk. God has ordained you for such a time as this. So you can't allow the enemy using the rejection thing. You were abandoned. That's another hurdle. Abandonment. You were dropped. Your mother, father, you might have been adopted. Don't know who your daddy is. Don't even know who your mommy is. Most of my life, I didn't know who my daddy was. I know he is now because I did a DNA test, found him, and, you know, we trying to have a relation now. Didn't meet him till about two years ago. Thank God that God allowed me to meet him, and he's still alive. But most of my life, I didn't know who my daddy was. And it hurt. You know that song Luther was saying, Dance with My Daddy? That song would come on, my wife would look at me and she'd see tears in my eye. Because I ain't never had a daddy to dance with. And that thing would hurt me. All my life, I would tell people, I wonder who my father is. Somebody walked past me in the street. I'm like, I wonder if he my father. You know, not knowing. I thank God I know now. And the bad part, well, I don't know if it's the bad part. Maybe the good part, I don't know. I look like him. You know, it's like, you know it's him. All right? We need no DNA test when I met him. Okay, but that is an issue that people are dealing with. That's a hurdle you got to get over because God has destined you to be spiritual daddy to a lot of people. And you say, well, how can I be that when I don't know? Because the Holy Spirit will give you everything you need. Another hurdle, inadequacy. You don't feel like you got it. My wife is good as that. As beautiful as my wife is, and that woman fine, boy. I might be biased, but I don't think so. I believe other people are like, she fine. My baby fine. But she be sitting up there feeling like, I don't know. And I be looking at her like, girl, you got it. I don't know why you get to that mindset. Just go on. You know, if I had what you had. See, I was born kind of bony, you know, and my, you know, bony, small wrist and all that. My wife has the perfect athlete's body. Okay? Perfect athlete body. Legs that I would die for. Arms that I would die for. You know? And I was like, what would I do with that? And she said up there, I hate my legs. I was like, oh, man. God, why you give people stuff that you could have gave me and I would have showed it off? You couldn't tell me nothing, boy, if I had them arms and legs. I'd have been walking around any place. You understand? That's how she caught me, with them legs shouting up in the church or back there in the West Coast. All right? But let me tell you, people of God, all right? You got to get over your inadequacy. Moses came and face to face with God. God said, Moses, I'm sending you to the people. You're going to deliver my people. And Moses said, I can't even talk. He stuttered problem. Lord, how you going to send me when I can't even talk? And God said, man, if I'm sending you, why are you worried about what you think you can't do? Evidently, I'm going to give you what you need. I'm going to give you what you need. So he had to go ahead, because Moses couldn't get over his inadequacy, and have Aaron be the spokesman. His brother Aaron to talk for him. You understand? You got to understand, it's a hurdle. But it's a hurdle. And what a hurdle's meant for? To jump over and keep going. Right? Another inadequacy. All right? Loneliness. I can't do it because I'm lonely. I'm so lonely. Me so lonely. Come on. Get out of that. Do you know how lonely the walk Jesus had? He up there took three closest allies with him into the Garden of Gethsemane the day before, you know, his greatest suffering. And guess what? They left him. Fell asleep on the man. Come on. Loneliness comes with this walk. It's a hurdle you have to get over. Even when you got a wife or a husband, you're going to be lonely in this walk because God has designed it that way. It is in those times that God can commune with you the most. You understand? He can fellowship with you. Get over that hurdle of loneliness. Another hurdle, being misunderstood. Now, I don't think there's nobody more misunderstood than me. You know, people always get me wrong. Then when they get to know me, I'm like, you know what? He is an all right guy. You know, his heart is in the right place. You know, but some people won't get to know me because they view me. Oh, he must be this way. You know, in my younger days, I don't know how y'all feel about me now, but, you know, I was an all right looking brother. So women didn't reject me too much at all. Okay? Had no problem in that area. So people would automatically think that I was conceited. But it wasn't. I had such shyness and, you know, self-esteem issues. But what I would do is put on my game face so you wouldn't know it. To get through that so you wouldn't use it against me. Do you understand what I'm saying? So you got to get over that hurdle of shyness. Get over that hurdle of inadequacy. Get over that hurdle of being misunderstood. You know, I hear that all the time. You don't understand me. You just don't understand me. Listen, I don't understand you, but God does. He made you. He created you. He understands everything. The Bible says at all points, Jesus was tempted and went through like us. He understands. He understands sexual frustration, loneliness. He understands temptation, all of that. Okay? And once you got him on your side, you got somebody that understands you. Get over that hurdle. All right? Now, another one. Underestimated. People always underestimate. I know people underestimate me. Come on, somebody. I know it. And I laugh at it. Because they don't know. I'll play dumb. You know, even when I'm sitting with lawyers and stuff, and they talk and thinking they... all their education, they know so much, and the Holy Spirit just give me the answer or wisdom. And sometimes when I go in and let them do what they want to do, and they mess up. That's why I got to be led by the Lord. All right? You should never underestimate somebody that has the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit will drop the answer right there. The bomb in Gilead. Drop the answer right there. You understand? You got to understand that. Another thing, people, that embarrassment and humiliation. You're going to get embarrassed in this walk. You're going to get humiliated. You want to know why? Because faith. This is the last thing because I'm running out of time and we're going to pick it up more on Thursday. But faith is an embarrassing walk because faith is misunderstood. Faith can't be comprehended by the flesh. So when people see you making faith moves, I'm gonna tell you, when I started this fight, people laughed at me. They, you know, I mean, even the judge, we was in court and she was like, Mr. Burns, where's your mother? Like, your mother, she got money, she's got a good reputation, all of this. How come she's not fighting this fight? Why are you here, Mr. Burns? Do you not know they say you had an issue with the law? And Mr. Burns, they say your grandfather, you know, couldn't stand you in his last days. And the judge brought all that up. And then God still showed me favor with the judge, but the judge said, you know, Mr. Burns, you got the house. You know, Mr. Burns, you understand? We shut down it all at, you know, at your word. And not only that, you didn't put this in your paperwork, Mr. Burns, but we even gonna make sure they can't do anything with any of the church property. Lock it all down. And I said, with all that, look what God will do. If God is for you, he's more than the world against you. You can go ahead and do this. You're going to be embarrassed in your walk. I was embarrassed when the judge was sitting up there bringing out my negative points because they had made it a point in court of all of my down settings to thinking they was going to win because they can convince the judge I'm not a good guy. But then when you got God on your side, the judge said, no, but I see what you're doing. You're thieves. I see. You're trying to steal this from the family. You're trying to take all of this. And the judge turned around and ruled in my favor. Come on, somebody. I'm trying to tell you what God will do in this race. Get over your embarrassment. Faith will always have you embarrassed. Noah was embarrassed. Do you hear me? Building that ark with no rain. It had never rained on the earth when he was building that ark. But when he finished, come on somebody, when he finished, the rains came down just like he was preaching the whole time. And I tell you, that I'm looking for that day, all the stuff I done preached, and I told you what's going to happen. when it fully manifests, boy, enter into the joy. If you do not know the Lord and the pardon of your sins, the Bible said the word is nigh thee, even in your mouth. If you confess Jesus, believe in your heart that he died for your sins and rose again for your justification, you are saved. Receive your salvation. Don't walk this earthly walk and die and go to hell. Lose your life when all you had to do was believe on Jesus Christ and accept the price he paid for the wages of our sins. Amen? Believe on him. I want to also thank y'all that given. Some of y'all even gave before I even start preaching, boy. And I'll tell you, that encourages me. All right? It is right to give. I don't care how you feel about, you know, giving. The Bible speaks about giving. You see, we have our Cash App there you can give. You can also Zelle us. All you got to do is DM me for the number. You can make sure you go to the Burns Memorial Church Cash App. All right? Burns Memorial Church. All right. And in any other way, PayPal, if you want to mail a check here, I'll give you the address, whatever, any way you want to give it. All right. We'll make it available for you to give. We thank God for your giving and we do not waste a dime of God's money. All right. I'm not running out buying Bentleys with God's people's money. All right. I'll have my Bentley one day and my daughter told me she's going to buy it for me. Amen. God bless y'all, and I love y'all. Thursday, get the rest of this word. Amen.